I want to ask Aylwin to continue, because we have to honor our offer and provide the things and so on.
Thank you. I want to tell a little bit about a very specific thing. I think when you want to buy Bitcoin, cryptocurrency, you basically enter a kind of ecosystem, and how do you buy all these things? But before, I would appreciate it if you can help me a bit, and maybe you can participate a little bit in answering some questions. And if it works, it's always a question, of course. If you can use your mobile phone, if you want to, and scan the code, or enter the address on top of it, menti.com, and then enter the code. That would be helpful. Does it work?
How many bitcoins are you stealing?
You just told us that it's safe.
No, nothing in there.
So my story will be about how to access the system and how to buy in simple terms, and what is the whole verification procedure around it. Because it's a simple thing, but it's a frustrating, at least for me, it's a frustrating part to buy it and to verify it. And the other thing is the considerations beforehand. But first, yeah, can I continue? Yeah, you can go to use the code, yes?
Thank you.
Okay. Let's see, full screen. So just in the beginning, I use it. So the first question, you asked it already, but I would appreciate if you just can answer in two words on the system. Why? What's your interest in Bitcoin? Why do you buy it, if you can define it just in two words? Is it because you don't lost them, for example, confidence in banks? You don't trust the euro or the dollar anymore? You want to do some, you have some black money you want to hide? Whatever. Freedom is, I think that's really at the core thing. The real believers, they're not going for the money, they're going for the freedom and the whole philosophy behind it. And decentralized. Ah, we really have good audience. People, decentralized investment, of course, trust, creativity, future. Ah, great, thanks. It's not so handy. This is for some people, it might be, could be one of the reasons we lost confidence in banks, and so the banks are basically forcing us to give the money instead of the other way around. And I have another question. I'll just come back on that. Because what I'm interested in is, do you know what is the size of Bitcoin? Because in the media, and you could get the impression that it's really big. But if we compare it to our global monetary system, do you have any idea of the size of it? That's what I want to show it. Yeah. If we compare it, for example, to the biggest company, I mean, they take the market capitalization. Apple is the biggest company. It's about Google, Apple, it's about the same level. The total value of Bitcoin, outstanding Bitcoin, compared to Apple, if you would fill that in and you choose, would it be about the same? Is Apple twice the size of Bitcoin? Apple is 20 times the size of Bitcoin. Bitcoin is twice the size of Apple, or Bitcoin is 20 times the size of Apple. What do you think? People are well informed here, apparently. compare it to Apple, for example, because Apple is 20, that's 20 times the size of Bitcoin. Bitcoin is about 40 billion euros now. Apple is around 750, 800, depending on the value of the shares at this point.
But isn't that that's still like super huge? I mean, the 20th of Apple is still like a lot.
Sure, it's a lot of money. It's a lot of money. But what I would like to show you in our next slide, as a monetary entity, Bitcoin is still so minor. And why I think that's important, because when you read media, you could get the impression that it's a threat already. But I don't think it's much too small for as a threat. The only threat could be that the system, the concept could be very good, so long term, it could be a threat not for us as a person, but a threat for centralized systems and power and these types of things. But at this stage, if we look at the size of Bitcoin, I won't go because it's a bit of, that's what I always like to discuss, but I won't do it here, is the financial situation in the world, the monetary situation. The real threat in our world is derivatives, which are huge. I won't go into detail there, but if you look at the total broad money we have, that's the surface of this big circle, this is Apple. If we now look to, that's the money we have globally. If you look to Bitcoin, this is Bitcoin. This is total cryptocurrency, so 40 billion, around 100 billion. So it's a lot of money, of course, but compared to the total system, the financial system we're living in, it's negligible, more or less. But it can become bigger. So just, you know, don't believe all these things about it's a threat already, because at this moment, at least, it's not. Okay. Oh, sorry, yeah, thanks. Yeah, you can give thumbs up and down if you don't like it, or if you don't like it, or if you don't like it. Then the second part I just want to touch, and you did it already, is privacy. And what I also would like, because like this gentleman, a lot of people say, I just don't care, I have nothing to hide. And that's what a lot of people say. So what I would like to know from you is that if you say, because I think it's quite hard, this issue, that we need to sacrifice privacy for security. Do you agree or do you disagree? Or do you say, I think the present balance we have is it's fine for me?
That's cool.
Great. Very interesting. Because I'm always wondering, because you always have a personal opinion, of course, but it's more important what other people think. Okay, thanks. Okay, now we'll go to the Bitcoin then, and cryptocurrency in general. And you told us already, when people say, you told me it's anonymous, but it's not anonymous. It's pseudonymous at best, and there are possibilities, and that's where I now want to start with, is to trace your identity. At least it's made easy. So what I want to start with now is how, and then I'll switch this off, do you buy a Bitcoin? There are a couple of, basically what we want is we want to go from the fiat world, the euro, because I'm somewhere you have to start. If you don't have cryptocurrency, you start with a euro. And you want to buy a Bitcoin, or you want to buy other altcoins. To do that, there are a few options. Either you just have a direct trade, of course, on the street or wherever. You meet someone, he gives you some cash, and he sends over a Bitcoin. I would not recommend to do that. Because, first of all, it could be unsafe. You never know how things go. And on the other hand, if we go back, for example, to criminals, for a criminal it wouldn't be very practical either, because then you have to go with 50 euros and meet people and, you know, don't make any speed with it. So that's direct trade. It's an option, but just for small amounts. The other possibility is that you pay something, you go to an ATM, you know, the money machines. You have a few. The disadvantage here is as well that it's limited in amounts, in most cases not more than 500 or 1,000 euros. The other disadvantage is you pay about 6 to 10% at the buying level, and you pay again, you know, if you want to exchange it when you sell, another 4% or so on average. So on a total cycle, it's about at least 10%, plus still limited in the amount you can transfer. Now, you have a few with credit cards or debit cards, whatever, where you don't have to verify, because that's the starting point. You don't have to verify. In most cases, that's limited to 100, maybe 500 euros. With some companies, you can buy more, but at that moment, you have to verify and basically reveal your identity. I'll show you later how that will work. The other disadvantage is most companies have huge fees. And what you will see on the bill often is a transaction fee of, let's say, 30 euros or 40 euros. But what they don't show is they add another 100 euro or 150 euro on Bitcoin, for example, in different market price. So altogether, it's a high fee. You have something else, which I call a local Bitcoin .r, which is kind of a digital marketplace. You can buy, basically it's peer-to-peer, so you make an appointment, or a digital appointment with someone else, and you can meet in person, but it's not a lot of trades via that option. Most of it, what you do is you have an escrow service, so basically you transfer your money from your bank directly into the bank of the person who's selling his Bitcoin, and then they block it. And once you post the money, you post agree that the deal is done, then it will be released. This advantage is, it's again limited, I think, and it depends, but it's limited in the number of Bitcoins, the amount you can convert, and also the cost is much higher. I think in average, will be about 6% or so as well. Because people live from it, they want to make money. So now we are at, let's say, the standard option is make use of exchanges. Now, exchanges, we have a lot. Just show you. These are the exchanges. There are about 200 exchanges. This is my list of exchanges. I have 40 accounts. Just to differentiate, first is where you do fiat money, euro, dollar, yen, whatever. There are only a few or a limited number who accept where you can buy or sell fiat money. When you look to euros, it's even much less. The other is which pairs do they have? And the pair is, for example, a Bitcoin euro combination or Ethereum. I guess most of you know what Ethereum is, or other altcoins, these kind of combinations. There's a huge difference. So, pairs, yes. The other thing is volume. You have exchanges with interesting pairs, but they sell, for example, half a Bitcoin per day. So there's no market, there's no liquidity. So prices are not at the market level. It doesn't work. Another important thing is cost and fees. For example, because we are now focusing more on, let's say, our euro or Dutch situation, you have a lot of these or a couple of these Dutch companies where you can buy with credit card or bank transfer a Bitcoin. But in most cases, the costs are considerably higher. That's at least in my experience. And you won't see it directly in a transaction fee, but just the market rate you get is worse than you would get with others. Now, from this whole list I have 40, what I told you, I have 40 accounts. There are only 5 which I personally would use that have euro, are reliable, and have reasonable cost. Sometimes you need an alternative because you want something fast, or I'll show you later, a lot of these exchanges have problems, they're down, there's fraud, there's whatever case there is, then you need an escape route, And then you can take, there are maybe five others where you can have euro. They are reliable, but they have a high cost. And next to that, there are about at least 10 exchanges where you can convert from Bitcoin or Ethereum to other altcoins, and that have a certain level of reliability. And how do you, go back. First step, you buy, you know these things. I would say, probably you go for an exchange. Next thing is, I told you there are several things, eh? The euro, the paras, the all these type of things. You select an exchange. I think that's something you have to do yourself. I would not recommend it, because there is not one single exchange without problems. They all have problems. Either it's capacity, security is okay, but there are a lot of cases like Mt. Gox from the past where there were issues. You have a danger of bankruptcy, I think, always. Many things. Wallets are not always safe. Also something will be touchy. So you select your own exchange. Then you make an account. Create an account. And what I think, what really important before you buy cryptocurrency nowadays, probably was different for let's say the pioneers 5 years ago or so, because they were anonymous. But if you now, we are at least as a normal person and a normal civilian, I want to buy a Bitcoin, I take my euros and I have to create an account and I have to verify. You really have to open your identity. There is no other way. There are ways, of course, but it's hard to find. It would not be practical. And if you want to do considerable amounts, there's no other way. So it starts with creating the account. What you need, I want you first. Okay. You know something because Hank asked already. Sorry, yes?
Why are they so careful with asking for passport and copies of it, etc.?
Yes.
If I go to a local bank and just want a copy of my passport.
Yeah, exactly. Now, I will show you because it's my number one annoyance when I started, because I never wanted to give anything away from my identity, but it's really impossible. So I ended up basically sharing everything, and I'll show you what. And it's all dumped on the internet, and it's even much worse, because a lot of these exchanges, the whole procedure just stops somewhere. You have no clue what's happening. But if you come back later, you see that all your data are just stored there. And you don't know who the counterparty is. So it's, I think that's one of the main issues I want to address here. So you start. What you need to fill in for an account is your name, your address, your phone number, because you get a confirmation on your phone number. So they immediately know your location, your IP address, all these things. Indeed, my question is, who is using a password manager? Because it needs to be secure. Great. Another one. And who would ever use two-factor authentication?
Trezor, is that an advanced tool or is it
just... Yeah, I would say that's an advanced tool. Because what I mean with advanced tools are things like an IP lock or time lock, all these type of things you can use as well. Okay, doesn't look too bad. No. And then you might think, okay, now I have the account, now I can start buying. And that's exactly your point. The answer is no, you can't do anything. With some exchanges you can buy maybe 100 euro, but with most you can't, because we have the ramp on, ramp off thing, or I call it also a verification wall they created. We have the crypto universe, the crypto ecosystem. And what we now got is the verification wall. It's a bit like the Iron Curtain, I think, and you could wonder yourself if you're on the west or on the east side nowadays. But what you need to do, you need to verify yourself. And it's also a problem for the exchanges, but it limits, because it limits their capacity. And it's, of course, a huge administrative burden. And it slows down the whole process. So what you will see is prices are going up and down, and the volume is increasing or high. You have to wait sometimes weeks for a support or whatever. go to the next one. So you get into the verification process. Now what I would like, to show how
my work works.
Yes.
Some of us, without any picture, apology or embarrassment, do not leave yet in smartphones.
No.
Can you purchase Bitcoin without having a smartphone? Or is it
it's a good point, but it's all right. It's hard. It's, I would say it's probably not impossible. But
yeah, the laptop, obviously.
Yes, but even with some exchanges, you get, because that's really annoying. You register your phone number, you immediately get a text message, and you have to confirm it. And it's even worse, because when you're in the verification stage, they tell you exactly what apps you have on your phone. Well, you never filled in anything. And via those apps, you have to confirm often. So for example, the two-factor authentication, you have different, I won't go into detail, but you have different options or methods to do it. But I think even most of the exchange, they only work with Google Authenticator, so you're even forced to work with Google, which is already, I think, something a lot of people not really appreciate.
Why do you think it's annoying?
Annoying?
Why do you think it's annoying?
Because we're working with a decent, people are, you know, driven by freedom, by a decentralized system, and what we get is we are forced, and what I show you later, is to share more privacy details and more personal details than we would have to do. And that you're forced to use a company like Google, yeah, I think I would, I don't intend to really appreciate it.
If it requires a cell phone number for verification, it's quite easy to steal somebody's cell phone number and to steal their Coinbase balance or get a cheap phone from AliExpress and use a separate SIM number for any password resets or anything.
Yeah.
Not just this, but also your Facebook.
Yeah, exactly.
Can we write down that you were it's a good idea, isn't it?
Just get a separate SIM card.
Yeah.
The Heyman Mobile is the cheapest one because it's valid for 12 months. So you pay a tenner every 12 months.
Exactly. That's good. Yeah, I also have a second phone for it. I use a Spanish phone.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Because I just hate it.
Okay,
so how it works. This is what I call the verification rule, and there is no way around. Maybe when you're really smart, but it's not practical. So what you do is you want to enter this system. This is the crypto. And when you're in the crypto ecosystem, then you really, I think, will appreciate how things work. It can be fast, it can be handy, you can convert money. You know, I feel it like freedom. But to enter, there are some conditions. So it depends. For the US, it's also a terrible process, it's even worse. For the euro, all fiat money. Yes, sure.
Actually, what I realize now is you can also put it this way. If you really want to be anonymous and don't want to share your private data, you're going to have to pay a price for it.
Yes.
And then you go to these ATMs that you showed.
Exactly.
They find 100%.
Right. Exactly.
And you have no privacy given
up. Exactly. No, you're right, because when I stepped in, I wanted to buy some of this stuff. And that's how I started. I went to ATMs, but I ended up paying in it. It was such a pain. And I was working with local bitcoins and whatever. But at the end, you know, I also want to know how it works. So like here. So I forced myself and went step by step. Because at first, you know, I switched off the computer again. I said, I won't do that ever. And the next day I thought, okay, I'll show you my driving license. And it goes, you know, further and further, and at the end, it's just lost, and you think, okay, now it's too late anyhow. Yes. Yes,
I think what you're saying is very right. You have a very specific position that you're talking from that I don't think is very clear.
Yes.
And that is like the absolute self-independency.
Yes.
We can also say that it's very easy to buy Bitcoin without really having to do all the verification.
Yes.
By buying a limited amount via, let's say, a Dutch website that connects to your bank account. So the only thing you need to confirm is that you're the owner of the bank account. You're still giving up your information.
Yeah, but it's still verification, of course, then form of. So your identity is revealed, then you have to work with really small amounts then. But if you know, for people who want to invest somewhat, But because just my last point, the other thing is, because a lot of people hope we will become very rich, you know, if we invest even 100 euro, and in a couple of years we have 100,000 euros. But if you want to convert that to euro, you have even a bigger problem, because it's impossible to withdraw your money out of the system, because then you will have the same verification issues. So if you really think that you will make a lot of money out of it, then you should already anticipate on it by being verified and have basically your escape route.
I know. I think you should say that the objective of the way you're describing it is to stay.
Yeah, exactly. That's exactly what it.
Because it is a financial system. It's not on the objective.
Exactly, that's right. You're right. That would be the ideal, but of course, we don't know how things will go, and if things crash, there are people who want to step out. But, okay, so how it works, I don't know if people are familiar with it, but let's say we have Bitcoin, which is the biggest, it's 40 billion. We have Ethereum, which was 30 billion, because it's going really now, today. Then you have a couple of major altcoins, Ripple, Litecoin, these type of things. These, and it depends on the exchange, you can buy directly with fiat money, but not all. But if you want specific altcoins, in most cases you need Bitcoins, and you can buy them, or some with Ethereum, but that's limited. So, and then it works without more or less without verification, and you can withdraw. To enter the system, you need to be verified first. Now, what does that mean? Sorry, this is for later. Switch it off. Okay, what is verification? I told you, right? It started just for my own experience. It started with my phone. And they immediately got the message, okay, you have Google Authenticator on your phone, please use it. That was step one, it's already annoying. Then, you know, I waited for a couple of days and then I thought, okay, I'll need a Bitcoin. So I thought, UID. And I thought, I don't like to give my password, that's just a stupid ID. They'll take my driving license, it's a bit safer. So you scan it, you know, front side, back side, it's in there. And you think, I'm ready. No, you're not ready. Because then you need to register your bank account. Then you need to register your credit card. And I say it's not, you know, it's a combination of these things. Huh? It depends on the exchange. Still, you're not there, because then the system broke down. It didn't work. Or they said, they store my information, but they say, you know, this driving license is not good enough. You're from Holland, because that they could identify. We need your passport. So your passport, you put in the system. And it's all, you don't know who you're dealing with, and what you're doing. Not good enough, because what you always need is a photo drive. And you cannot just upload one, it should be on your web. You should make your photograph. And in most cases, they also want you to do it with your ID together. Now you upload it, and now there are even some exchanges, they require a video. So they call you back to verify if you're indeed the person and just to ask you a couple of simple questions. Okay, in most exchanges, now you can trade up to 1,000 euros. If you want to go higher, level 3 or level 4, then you need more. They want my latest statement of my bank account, and my name should be on it, and it should be exactly the same as my account name, my birthday, and if the birthday is wrong, because I always type in the wrong birthday, then they won't verify, and you wait for months. The other thing, this whole procedure takes weeks. It's still not enough because they want proof of residence. So you take your rental agreement, for example, which is not enough because your name might be in there, but you already live there. So please, can you tell me the law as well? And now, what else do we have to share? I think nothing. But maybe there are some who require fingerprints. And then you're verified, and now you can continue. Happy and And then there are, you know, just practical complications, because sites go down. What I told you already, I had at least, on average, with the average, I think when I tried 5 exchanges, at the end I tried, I did it with 10. I succeeded with only 2. And I needed at least 10 efforts to come through. And you never get any feedback from, you know, okay, thank you for your details. You just you know, don't know what's going on.
So frustrating process.
So Richard,
all these extensions are still under country's regulation.
Yes.
They just follow
exactly.
Every financial
they have
system is the same.
Yeah, exactly. This law.
So it's not special to.
No, but when I open a bank account, I don't have to share that much information, and at least I'm talking to one person, and I can also, if something goes wrong, I can also address the issue at the bank, and that's what's impossible. So, you know, you get all this legislation and all these, you're forced to share these things, but, you know, you cannot claim anyone or you sue anyone if it's wrong. So it's just one way. Okay, so then you're in, and then things are much easier. I'm just wondering, because I don't want to fit all steps, time, sorry, so.
Yeah.
Make it too long. What you do, the next step is you deposit your money. Your euro. So you're allowed to deposit. One thing, if there is, I think in 70% of cases, something goes wrong and your deposit will be on hold. Because maybe you misspelled something or whatever reason. It even happens. The first time you always have to verify your account and your deposit. So then you always. And if you're in a hurry because prices are going up, you know, you're waiting for all the time and you wait a week and you know, and you lost, you know, hundreds of euros because they're too late. And then finally you get your deposit is released, but you know, prices are skyrocketing and you're far too late, so don't give it any longer. These things happen. Normally, the second time, they should look at your first deposit and it should be released automatically. Now, I can tell you, maybe that happens in 10% of the cases, but in many cases, it's just on hold again. When you have that, you can trade. Then you finally can buy your Bitcoin. And that is something really fast and efficient. You just put in your order, 10 seconds later, you have your Bitcoin. At the price you enter, that works fine. The cost is about, depends, but at a good exchange it's about 0 to 5% or 0.5%. Yeah.
You still have to wait for the transaction to get verified, and if you use Bitcoin, it takes about 40 minutes.
No, that's it. Now I went from Euro to Bitcoin, for example, as an example, on that exchange, that's done immediately. If you now want, and I'll comment that point as well, if you want another altcoin, most exchanges don't have the exotic ones. They have just a few. Sometimes they only have Bitcoin. Then you have to transfer indeed your Bitcoin to another exchange, and there you write. That can take theoretically up to an hour. So it can also take much longer. And that has to do with the efficiency, the capacity of the Bitcoin network. And for other altcoins, it can be really fast.
And when you have to wrap up.
Yes, I'll wrap up. Okay. So that's great. Then you have withdrawal, and that's exactly where SEP will come in. Now, here you have the same or even stricter limitations to exit the system, basically, if you would like to do that. And I just want to give you one, and that's a really important recommendation, also, well, there it is. It's never, I hope you understood, that exchanges are not the most reliable part. And at this moment, I don't think you find one exchange that you really can rely on for 100%. So what you should never do is what you should always do is limit your exposure to exchanges. If you buy a Bitcoin and you got it and you have a wallet, then please learn this lesson. Take it from your wallet to your own wallet, to your own cold store, preferably. Because the wallets that you use on an exchange, or basically on your account, you won't even see it as a wallet with most exchanges. The keys are managed by the exchange. If the exchange goes broke, or whatever happens, or there's fraud, you lose everything. And it's a valid risk. So the lesson is that the lesson here is that if you don't control the keys, you don't control the Bitcoin. Possession is 9/10 of the law, and in Bitcoin, possession of the keys is 10/10 of the law. If you don't control the keys anymore, it's not your Bitcoin. That lesson will be learned as many times as it needs. So always make sure that you transfer your Bitcoin to your own wallet and don't link to that other exchange. Okay, thanks.
Are there any questions in between? I think we need a break as well. You can take two questions now.
Well, I'm still, because it was mentioned several times. How is it called? A cold store?
Yes. Cold storage. Yes.
Okay. Like cold or cold?
It's cold.
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 Cold. Okay.
As in cold so life.
Yeah. Okay. Great.
There you go.
Well, a piece of paper is a cold storage.
Yes, that's a cold storage. So.
I had very practical questions, and I thought they were going to be addressed. I wouldn't expect to create a new email account for any exchange, for example, I'm buying from.
Yes.
Because, I mean, if all my email is coming in to one account, let's say all the exchanges, if that gets, let's say, hacked or...
Yes.
It's basically immediately getting access to it. So that would be like a very practical thing I would do. But do you have maybe something else or similar?
Oh, it's even more, I didn't do it so far myself, but I should do it, is that to protect your email traffic, which we have with PGP, pretty good privacy, so that it cannot be hacked, because it's also a risk, I think. When you make a deposit or a withdrawal or a trade, you always get a message from the exchange. So it's already easy if your email account is hacked, at least the hacker knows already which exchange is your input. So that's...
Who would be interested in a question like this gentleman? We could do a follow-up after the summit that has many practical do's and don'ts, but we needed this session first because you have to take everybody with you. You have to first get the feeling that you need to secure your keys first, and then you can think of how you do it. Would there people be interested in a how session after the summit? Just
a privacy.
I think a general question that should be then addressed is who do you, one, chooses to protect from? And there's a lot of different answers, they're very different.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, are we trying to protect ourselves, state entities? Are we trying to protect ourselves from potential thieves? They are very different
I do agree,
ways of choosing.
Yeah, I do agree there's several ways to look at it.
Yeah.
Security is a definition you can go everywhere, anywhere you like. But I think there's a common denominator as well. So we could take a few like practical tips like PGP or work from a wallet that's hierarchical deterministic, how to work with seeds in general. We could do that. I think there's quite a few things to address that we would need more hours than we will consume today.
Will exchange accept you when you're behind the store network?
I don't know exactly. I cannot give you the answer.
It differs. Some do. For sign up, most of them do. But for withdrawals, once they're trying to withdraw behind a VPN or behind a Tor network, most of them probably don't.
Okay. Just gentlemen,
get.
I had just one feeling that I get, and thank you for the presentation. You showed all these different things that you need to show to get verified. It's nice and it's interesting, but that would be if you, I would like to put it a little bit into a perspective of when you want to become a trader of altcoins and really want to go into different, not so common coins. If you're like new to the scene and you just are interested in buying for 100 euros worth of Bitcoin.
Yes, for 100 euros it would be fine, but if you're already talking about 1,000 euros, you need to be verified already.
But still not that complicated. I mean, there's like bitcasa.nl and...
Yes, but then you pay of course you're right, but you pay in fee.
1% upon the Kraken exchange rate. I don't find that very much. I don't need to show my passport scan. What I do is I transfer 1 cent from my bank account.
Yes.
So they use the
bank
account that they gave to my bank.
Yes.
And it's transferred to the same account.
Yes.
So that's your bank account.
That's your bank account.
You're not anonymous.
I'm not saying that one is not anonymous. I'm just saying
that it's if you're not very ambitious, yeah. Life is actually not that
complicated. No, of course, but I hope I stated that as well. If you just have small amounts, it's not so much of a problem. But still, the conceptual problem is, of course, that you share your identity with the bank account because they know that the bank has all the information as well. And so they have to trace, and you know, a lot of people participate in the network, but we don't.
The word survival kit.
Right.
Yeah. The word survival kit is for everybody different. Yeah. If you're in the sea, it will have a total different meaning, and you're new to the words. We try to get a discussion going about creating your own survival kit using the information that we get here from the speakers, as well as the handout we will send you later, and you can combine them. You know, it's your survival kit. We have a pause of 5-10 minutes.